Microlecture 28, The Mexican Revolution. In 1876, Porfirio Díaz became president of Mexico. He was a decorated war hero and an important figure in President Benito Juárez's government. Juárez was the person who built the Mexican state and expelled the French after their invasion. Díaz was from a generation of liberal thinkers who created a legal and political framework based on constitutional principles established in 1857. Despite a liberal agenda, the country still faced many challenges due to poverty and lack of infrastructure. Porfirio Díaz rose to power based on a discourse of law and order and promised that the government will develop the country while attracting foreign investment. Díaz built a regime that gave the country tremendous political stability after many years of internal conflict. Díaz stayed in power for 35 years between 1876 and 1911 and is widely recognized as one of Latin America's most important dictators. Díaz ruled by the mantra of bread or stick, rewarding supporters and punishing opponents. Díaz's political stability was good for the economy and foreign investors, but really bad for ordinary people who continue in poverty. The Porfiriato was a modernizing regime. Railroads were extended at an unprecedented level, and also groups of scientists and technocrats were hired to transform society. However, the Porfiriato used its modernizing mission and economic development to oppress working class people and people of color. Economic progress enriched Díaz and his allies, but proved to be very bad for rural and indigenous communities who suffered a lot and lost their lands. Large landowners monopolized the most productive regions, leaving peasants abandoned and forgotten. By 1910, 80% of the rural population did not have land. Even though the country was getting more prosperous, more modern, and more connected, the terrible social conditions that people were experiencing led to the first great social upheaval of the 20th century, the Mexican Revolution. In 1908, feeling that his last years were coming, Porfirio Díaz gave an interview to the American magazine Persons. In that interview, he promised not to run for president in 1910 because he was tired after 35 years in power. However, he broke his promise, and in 1910, he declared himself the unanimous winner of the election. After the crook election, Díaz defeat challenger and wealthy landowner Francisco Madero, issue a manifesto calling the election illegitimate, and named himself the provisional president of Mexico. Madero's call was the spark that triggered the Mexican Revolution and opened the path for peasants and workers who were grieving for opportunities, land, or jobs. Peasants and workers across the country rose, dropped out Díaz, and named Madero as the country's provisional president. Madero was not a good enough political leader, and peasants in many parts of the country rebelled again. Seeing that Madero was not defending American interests, the US ambassador conspired to remove and kill Madero in 1912. It was the beginning of a factional period in which many sides fought each other to control the country. Emiliano Zapata was the leader of the Zapatista movement and probably the ideological referent of the conflict. The Zapatistas were landless peasants from the southern part of the country. The Zapatistas made their demands in a document called the Plan de Ayala, that demanded the return of all land, forests, and waters taken from rural communities. Pancho Villa was a charismatic leader from the northern part of the country who soon joined the struggle. Villa is perhaps the most famous leader of the revolution and the one who impacted popular culture the most. Supporters of the Plan de Ayala were gradually beaten by a faction called the Constitutionalists, whose leaders were Venustiano Carranza and Álvaro Obregón. Both of them were eventually presidents of Mexico and are often considered the victors of the revolution. Carranza and Obregón had to negotiate with Villa and Zapata, and when they signed a new constitution in 1917, it incorporated parts of the Plan de Ayala. Large states were confiscated to make communal land grants called ejidos, which then were assigned to rural communities. More than 80 million acres of farmland were redistributed using the ejido system. The Constitution sealed the agreement between the rural communities and the constitutionalist elites, who consolidated and reinforced their power for the next 90 years with the formation of a political party called the PRI. Villa and Zapata were not that lucky. A general called Pablo González assassinated Zapata following Carranza's orders. Zapata's assassination is one of the great betrayals in history. Villa had similar luck. After retiring from politics, a group of seven riflemen assassinated him in 1923 after a well-planned conspiracy led by Álvaro Obregón. The first social upheaval of the 20th century was a violent struggle that transformed the history of the Americas. The influence of what happened during the Mexican Revolution can still feel today. The legacy of Villa and Zapata continues to be celebrated today in Mexico and in other parts of the world. This is all I have for you today. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.